Well, ever since the acquisition of the property in Garden Grove, the former Crystal Cathedral property, much has been happening in a relatively short period of time.
We've been entrusted with something huge here, this legacy of the Crystal Cathedral ministries and the grounds and these beautiful buildings.
This remarkable campus spans 35 acres, incorporates 7 buildings. We're going to take you into the process that allowed us to develop a remarkable vision for the Christ Cathedral and the surrounding campus. We didn't build these buildings. They were entrusted to us by the congregants of the Crystal Cathedral Ministry and Dr. Reverend Schuler and his wonderful wife, Arbella.
It's my prayer that folks will see that this gift of God, which is given to us, is not just for us, but it's for the ages.
This is a working campus. It has a parish which has over 12,000 people a weekend visit here and celebrate Mass here.
Beauty draws. God's light draws, so people can be drawn here and then maybe reconnect with their faith or just find a place of rest, beauty, and reflection in the middle of the city.
So we see ourselves as a center point for many faiths to come together and engage.
We have become, the Roman Catholic Church, the inheritors of 3 beautiful, iconic architectural buildings. The first building was by the American architect Richard Neutra. He designed what we call the Arboretum as well as the Tower of Hope. We also have the beautiful Philip Johnson Cathedral itself, and then we have the Richard Meyer Cultural Center. These 3 architects really are signature iconic architects of the United States of the 20th century.
The Arboretum was the first indoor worship space for Dr. Schuler and his community, and it lent itself very well for renovation for Catholic worship. There are 11 Masses Saturday and Sunday in that Arboretum in English, Spanish, and Vietnamese.
And now we focus our attention on the heart and center of that campus, which is the transformation of the former Crystal Cathedral into Christ Cathedral.
What we have to do is basically transform it from a space that was designed for the liturgy of the word, preaching, proclamation, in a kind of a TV studio production environment, and change it into a space where liturgical worship can take place.
So the elements of altar, cathedral, ambo, baptistry, devotional spaces, Eucharistic chapel, crucifix, those are all of the central items that the present building does not have. And that's what we're incorporating as part of the renovation designs.
We decided to go with 2 different architects, Johnson Fain for the interior of the cathedral and Rios Clemente Hale Studios for the exterior.
And so we've really thought about how you make a space feel sacred and how do you do that for the cathedral, that as you arrive, all of a sudden you're in this moment of awe and you really feel the presence of God.
I liken the new design and construction to a building within a building. The exterior building is pretty much restored, the glass building, and then we're building an entirely new interior from within. The cathedral would be right here, and the principal entry to the cathedral will be here. The ambo will be here, altar here, and cathedral there. All of that happens within the zone of the predella, which is here and is elevated 3 steps up.
You gotta love it, and then embrace it, and take all of its virtues, be creative, and create a new thing which honors and builds on what was here before. That's not only being respectful, that's also being intelligent.
Around the cathedral building will be a major change because we're going to create a plaza that is a rectangular plaza that surrounds the cathedral itself so that the cathedral will sit in the middle of the whole campus. And our diocesan motto, if you will, is together we journey, together in faith. And so the way that we're designing the exterior of the cathedral is going to reflect that journey.
You know, I think we want to make a place that's totally welcoming to everyone. And so having spaces that before a service that people can gather in, that there's shade, that there's perhaps the sound of water, there are places for kids, there are places you might get a cup of coffee. That's really important to make this place usable and allow it to be a really great Catholic gathering point.
This is an opportunity to do something extraordinary. The problem is extraordinary. The conditions we find are extraordinary. Hopefully the outcome will be extraordinary. At the same time, renew the historic peace and respect it and let them both kind of live together.
What this campus and this building, the cathedral, give us is a place to gather, to worship, to witness, to serve.
Having this campus provides us the opportunity to be the church at its best, which ultimately will be a place where people will come and know and believe that they are loved by God.
This is only a step on the journey. This isn't the end of the journey. It's about roots and where we've been and where we're going. And so holding on to both of those.
I know what Dr. Schuler thinks about what we're doing on the campus because I asked him personally. And he told me that he was extraordinarily pleased with everything that we've done. We're honoring his vision, but he asked us to do more. He said we must never rest in our efforts to reach out to the entire community. And so we have as a mission on this campus to reach out to all across the world, not just in our own diocese or in the state, but throughout North America and the entire Catholic community of the world.
What I would hope when visitors come here is they take away, above all, a sense of welcome, a sense of connectedness, a sense of beauty, a sense of music, all those things where God can be known.
My great hope for our cathedral is that it will be a place that celebrates unity, solidarity, and the oneness that is ours as God's holy people here in the Diocese of Orange.
Three entrances are really the narthex, or principal entrance, off the plaza, the baptismal entrance off the baptistry, and the pilgrim's entry off of the rotunda.
The central entrance is called the festal entrance, which comes from festal as in festivity, feast. So this is the entrance that contains a pair of monumental doors that will be opened only on festal occasions. Great feast days, great moments of liturgy, and when those doors open up, the crowd will have started outside and then will come through the great doors and enter the cathedral. We put the baptistry on the west side because it allows the ancient tradition of coming in from the west, and when you're baptized, going down into the water and arising on the east side. The west is the darkness where the sun sets. You come in facing the east where the sun comes up. So it's the passage from dark to light. The other thing is that the cemetery is over on that side. And the rite of Christian funerals is really meant to be a metaphor for the journey through life. So when the body is brought to the font for the last time, the deceased is sprinkled with water from baptism as a reminder that they already died in baptism and rose up to new life, and that this was, in a sense, the spiritual metaphor for what eventually would happen.
There is an entrance which is really off of Lewis and Chapman, and that is referred to as the Pilgrim's Entrance, because many visitors to the cathedral that will be coming to see this beautiful building, to gather for prayer, etc., will be coming in from the Pilgrim's Entrance.
The plaza will give them entree to the east entrance, and the whole metaphor there is the idea of pilgrimage and that you're going up to the house of the Lord.
One comes in to the household of believers through the waters of baptism. And so the place where the baptismal font, the baptistry, is located is critically important within the structuring and building of a Catholic church. And certainly within a cathedral, the place of baptism is extremely important. Baptism reflects death and resurrection. It also reflects the fact that it is through those waters that we become members of the body of Christ. And so it is located near that side entrance. The font itself will be recessed into the floor to accommodate individuals actually walking down into the water so that they can be immersed for the baptismal sacrament. Babies can be held in the arms of their parents as water is lifted out of the font and poured over that child's head. And the font itself is designed in a very ancient pattern, a cruciform pattern.
The floor is travertine. It's what we call silver travertine. It's highly grained material from Italy, and it'll be patterned in various ways, but it will track through the main congregational floor and out into the baptistry floor. And then there's a series of stones that will define the rail and the font itself. The walls of that baptistry are onyx. Onyx is a kind of marble which is cut very thin, and it's translucent with high color and figural patterns through it. So as the sun rotates in the sky, it will throw light through the onyx. Think of a stone that's like paper. So you see light through it, which will illuminate the figural nature of the stone and bring light into that baptistry.
There will be two doors, which I would call functional doors, for people to come and go. That's on the north and the south. On the west side are the ceremonial doors, which are only open for funerals and baptisms. Those will probably be bronze, and they will be expressions of life and death, because that's really what the baptistry is about. When you enter on that axis, you will step into the room, and in the center is a circular, what we call a knee wall, a wall that's only about maybe at the most 30 inches tall. And it will be in four segments surrounding the font. At the bottom of the font, which will be probably mosaic, very dark blues, will be a gold Cairo. That's the, for what most people would call the P and the X, which is a monogram for Jesus Christ. So you enter into the death of Jesus Christ coming from the west, the dark, and then you rise up out of the water three steps and you head in the east into the cathedral. On the knee wall will be a permanent paschal candle where the Easter candle will reside throughout the year. During the time of Easter, the candle will be at the ambo. The ambry will be in that room where the holy oils are kept. And the other thing that people will not probably be familiar with is the catafalque, which is where the casket is placed when a body is brought to the cathedral. And it's placed in the baptistry, again, as a reminder of dying. We have already died with Christ, with the promise of new life and resurrection. One of the biggest challenges of the building is the amount of light that comes into the building. It really does heat up in here. And we're sitting here right now, and we can feel the passive solar energy coming in through the glass. So we have come up with this idea that the scaffolding itself is angular and so forth, but it's in modules that are square.
Sometimes they're closed and all they have is just a little line through them, so they're like that. Sometimes they open a little bit more. You can see the depth there, because we want a little more light to pass through. Sometimes we want them to open a whole lot more, so they're even deeper and they open more, such as you see, and they have greater depth. Now they'll all be in the same plane, but some will be deeply opened and some will be flat. One of the jobs it does is that it allows the light to come in when it's favorable. For example, if we're sitting together and we're facing the east and looking at the altar, we're on the west side of the building looking to the altar, and the east is behind us. In the morning at 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock, that's probably not very good, right? The sun is right there. I'm looking at the altar and the clergy, and behind it is the rising sun. So I don't want a lot of light there. So we've mapped all of those needs and those performances, and there we'll be using, you can be sure, more of the closed petals. Once it gets up higher and out of our view line, well, then we can open them up, bring light down into the middle of the sanctuary. And then if it comes and drops behind me in the west, I'm in good shape because I've got a lot of natural light in this way. But if I'm sitting where the camera's sitting, looking this way, I'm looking into the sunset. So those are going to have more of the flatter, the ones that are more opaque.
They're not adjustable. They'll be in fixed positions. But the end result will be that the light that comes in here will be very soft. You'll get some patterning of light and shadow on the floor, but nothing as severe as what occurs right now. And as the course of the day proceeds and the sun moves, this room will be continually changing, and some of the quatrefoils will glow. Sometimes they'll go in shadow. So it's a very solar, celestial kind of experience. I think it's going to be very exciting.
These are the volumes you can see here. And you can see they're coded by color as to the degree of aperture or not. So you can see many are closed here, they open here. You can see down in the far extremities of the building at the east and west, they tend to be closed more because of sight lines, which direct sun as it's low to the horizon would be problematic. And then they have all been randomized, so they create a pattern. Now these will all be white on white on white on white, so in the real building, these colors won't exist, but they help us visualize how the different apertures are distributed over the building.
We have a number of plans for the design of the interior of the cathedral building itself. To make it a place of Catholic worship, there needs to be an altar.
It is the altar within our Catholic theology that is the symbol of Christ in our midst.
We created models, and we studied the orientation and location of the altar, and thinking of all those great cathedrals in Europe. And what we came up with at the end of the day was an idea of a central altar, which you see here, this being that central altar. And what that meant is it put the congregation really surrounding the activity of the altar, brought them in closer, and made it the focus of the centrality of the building.
If we were to have maintained the kind of configuration that was here when the cathedral ministries was functioning, it would have meant that there were huge distances between an individual and the altar or the sanctuary. By putting a central axis with the altar in the very center, essentially cut the distance in half for a lot of people. The reason it's perfectly square is so that it's approachable from all sides. It doesn't have a front and a back and a left and a right. Above it will be suspended a liturgical cross, liturgical in the sense that it's meant to be very symbolic of what's happening at the altar when the people bring the gift of their lives in bread and wine. It's offered up at the altar with Jesus Christ once and for all sacrifice on the cross, and the cross will be suspended directly over the altar.
What can be seen under the altar table will be a small but beautifully fabricated reliquary in which the remains of those who have given their life for the faith will be reverently deposited. And it conveys that beautiful historic continuity that we have in our faith, that the altar table in ancient times was so often built above the tomb of the martyrs, those who have given their life for Christ.
The organ is an extraordinary instrument. It's one of the largest in the world, has the greatest range and capacity. It's a historic piece of its own, part of musical history, and it's been added to over time. It essentially provides sound, obviously, from its main location, but also opposite on the opposing side of the building, and then also from the ends, the extreme corners of the mezzanine, sound is projected. The organ pieces now are in Italy, being carefully restored. In a sense, of all the things we're doing, it's interesting and maybe sounds unusual to say that the restoration of the sound-making elements of the organ is probably the longest lead item. The building was originally environmentally not conditioned, and the way the building was ventilated was through a series of glass fins that opened, and as the air came in, it brought things that air brings in, like carbon monoxide and birds in some cases. It brings in salt from the ocean, which is nearby, and all those things over time tend to corrode the metal that are the pipes of the organ. What we're involved in is a restoration of the interior of the organ. There are also cells, obviously, and wells inside, and we will replace all of the pipes, restore that. But there's a question of the exterior casements as well. We're interested in rethinking the graphics of its skin in a way that brings it into kind of unity with the rest of the travertine, the battered walls, the seating, the pews, the elements of the predella. So we're trying, it will be much lighter. Right now it's a dark wood and it's become discolored. So we see it as really a beautiful white thing that will reflect light and will become part of the whole skin of the building.
Because architects have been working diligently at making sure that the primary liturgical symbols are appropriately positioned within the cathedral proper, we have had to make some accommodation for the organ positioning, etc. Now, of course, the great organ pipes that you see in the north section of the cathedral will remain where they are, but we are repositioning where the choir will be located. One of the reasons for that is because we had to elevate that floor to accommodate the Blessed Sacrament Chapel underneath. The choir itself would be too close to those organ pipes, and so we are moving them to the south balcony to an area that will beautifully accommodate a choir of about 120 that could be augmented for big festivals. The organ console will also be repositioned on the south balcony. And all of the musicians that have been involved in this project have said this is the ideal positioning and placement for both the choir as well as the organ console.
If you want to say, is there an instrument that holds a place of pride, it's the organ. It will function both as a concert instrument and also its primary function, that of worship. One of the interesting things is that when we spoke with Frederick Swan, who used to be the organist here, one of the principal organists, he observed that when they did the Glory of Christmas and the Glory of Easter, they had to move the choir from the north side, where the major part of the instrument is, over to the south side. But the interesting thing was that when they got over there, the choir could hear better and it could actually serve better because it was not so overwhelmed by the instrument.
There will of course be organ music, there will of course be choral music, there will of course be chamber music, but there may be many other kinds of music as well. The opportunities for musical worship really are up on the mezzanine, and there will also be, they will principally, the choral location will principally be on the southerly end. Now that's a change from what happened before. If you remember in the evangelical life of this building, that everyone entered this way principally, and to some degree this way, and the altar was all at the end. So it made sense that the chorus would always be there on the altar at the end. What's happening now with the centrality of the altar and the population, the congregation around it, we had the opportunity to leave this as the location for the principal organ music and then bring the choir over to the other side. We also have greater capacity on this southerly side, so we have flexibility for larger chorus groups. In the former life, really the support functions for the church were on the lower level. We have support functions in the bottom, in the basement, if you will, of the church as well, the cathedral, but we also have some very important liturgical spaces. Notably, we have the Chapel of St. Callistus. We have the columbarium there as well. And then we have a series of side chapels, as yet unnamed, but will develop as we continue with design and construction.
Because there'll be a lot of occasions where worship will happen at the cathedral, where the scale of this room would be completely inappropriate. I mean, you just get swallowed up in here. So this lower level chapel, it's very intimate. It will also give you entree to the crypt where the columbarium is for cremated remains, and it will also be where the bishops of Orange will be interred.
There will be vesting areas for priests. There will be choir rehearsal space. There will be the crypt, as well as columbaria niches for the interment of cremains.
The ministers will prepare, and then they will process up the pilgrim stair, the metaphor, the inspiration of we are all on the journey, making our way, going back to that from which we came.
Surrounding the cathedral will be a great grand courtyard. And if you can imagine that the cathedral is shaped like a diamond, it will be placed inside a rectangle. And so the areas around the diamond, inside the rectangle, there'll be four of them. And each of these plazas will have a specific name and a specific function. The first will be the Pilgrims Plaza. And that's the area where visitors will get out of their buses or out of their cars. And it's really the first introduction that they'll have to the campus.
We've planned in the Pilgrims Courts to have a cafe, there may be a bookstore, information center. There's a really incredible fountain so that kids and parents can sort of be in water and symbolically cleanse themselves to prepare for this sort of journey in the cathedral.
There's a tradition in pilgrimage that when you arrive to a great pilgrimage site, there's always water and you could bathe and clean yourself up. And so that corner of the plaza will have a water element that's probably very pedestrian friendly, water that comes out of the ground, and you can walk between it, you can play in it, you can do all those things.
The main courtyard, located next to the Cathedral Cultural Center and the Tower of Hope, will be the Bishop's or Festal Plaza. And this is where the main goings-on of the campus will take place.
It's going to have a beautiful ring of trees around it. And underneath all the trees are seating areas so that you can be in a service in the main space, or you can sort of be a little bit on the side, like on a colonnade, and be under a tree canopy. So really trying to make it be a space for focused services, events, and activities.
Now the Marian Corner will be quite interesting. This is the corner that will be located in the northeast. We're going to have an area that will hold between 8 and 20,000 people for an outdoor mass.
The Court of the Catechumens is in the northwest corner of the plaza, and it forms part of this understanding of the relationship of the catechumens and how they enter the church.
The catechumens are the people who are preparing for baptism. That's the ancient name for them. And so the baptismal area is going to be sitting kind of outside the building. So people will be baptized and then walk into the cathedral itself.
This is very important because it's located between the baptismal font and the memorial gardens. So you have the entire travel between birth and death. Well, the Arboretum was an amazing challenge for us. And it was an amazing challenge because we had two big obstacles. One is we had scope, and one is we had time. The scope was supposed to be just a simple retrofit. We were just going to go in there and we were going to take our little hothouse, as we called it, because this was a building that was unair conditioned and was all glass, and so you could grow orchids in there beautifully, but not so good with the priests with their big vestments. So we were going to air condition it, and we also wanted to make it safer, seismically.
I think, as many people know, one of the wonderful aspects of this campus is that we have become, the Roman Catholic Church, the inheritors of three beautiful, iconic architectural buildings. The first building was by the American architect Richard Neutra. He designed what we call the Arboretum as well as the Tower of Hope. The Arboretum is classic, quintessential Richard Neutra.
Our challenge was, as soon as we got into the building, it literally started to fall apart in our hands. The first thing that you do when you renovate a building is you do some what they call destructive testing, where you get inside and you make sure that what's actually in the building is what's on the plans. And when we got in, we found that not only what was in the building was different from the plans, but that itself was falling apart. We respected the design of the building, and we went in and we renovated the building to what we called its period of significance. What's the period of significance? That's where the building was of most impact on the surrounding architectural condition. And for us, we decided that that would be 1964. Looking back through all of the historical photographs, we were able to discern exactly where the original color palette was. And when you go into the Arboretum, you'll notice that on the east side, the columns are all that beautiful brown suede, and the columns on the west are beautiful white.
I am so pleased that that work was done so delicately and carefully to bring the Neutra structure back to its pristine condition. It was so successful that it recently received an architectural award for achieving precisely that end.
It was taken all the way down to the studs, basically, and then rebuilt using historical pictures and everything to its point of its most luster. We installed air conditioning, which wasn't there before. It's very seismically safe. We redid all the windows for energy efficiency, reconditioned the organ that's there. So it's basically a brand new building, but looks like it was just designed by Neutra in the 1960s. It's really incredible.
What it means for the community here is that we can have mass here before we actually open up the cathedral building.
There are 11 masses Saturday and Sunday in that arboretum in English, Spanish, and Vietnamese. So it already is really a big heart of the activity here on the campus.
It's a beautiful worship space because that's what it was originally intended to be. And it's really, at the moment, our point of unity here on the campus, where the community gathers in large numbers. It is significant to the Crystal Cathedral Ministries because it was the original church that Dr. Robert Schuller built. So it really has a spiritual significance that's very profound for both of the communities of Shepherd's Grove now and Christ Cathedral Parish.
The design team, the builders, and the bishop wanted our work on the Arboretum to be best in class. It is one of the safest structures in all of Orange County. And that's very important because this campus is more than just an emotional haven. It should also be a physical haven. So if there is ever a disaster, if there's ever an issue in Orange County, the one piece of infrastructure that you want to have fully operational is a place where people would worship. The Tower of Hope is another remarkable gift that we've been given. So this was a building that was designed by Richard Neutra and his son Dion and was constructed in 1968.
It has an incredible chapel in the sky, which is very unusual for this cathedral in that it will continue as a non-denominational chapel. So people that aren't Catholic can celebrate weddings there. That's a very unusual step. It really shows the heart of the Catholic Church here being about ecumenism and interreligious dialogue and work together. That's a wonderful element. So this will be very much a working tower, but also have this incredible thought center within it and the ability to broadcast that nationally and globally.
The Tower of Hope will not only accommodate the offices for the cathedral staff, but because of the fact that there is additional space available, it will also house certain national Catholic organizations that will be utilizing that site as kind of the center of their ministry and work, not only here in the County of Orange, but throughout the United States.
The Tower of Hope is called the Tower of Hope because it was the original home of New Hope Ministries, a suicide prevention hotline. It started about 40 years ago, and the Catholic Church is taking on that ministry now from the Crystal Cathedral Ministries under the sponsorship of Catholic Charities.
The Tower of Hope's an unusual building because it has an odd aspect ratio. And so we've had a challenge trying to make that building as safe as possible. And we chose cutting-edge technology using what we call viscous dampers, essentially a giant shock absorber. And so it will make that building one of the strongest in Orange County, and again, a great haven for the parishioners and the residents of the diocese.
As we renovate the interior of the cathedral, we are also going to be renovating the exterior grounds. And so really the outer envelope of the whole cathedral is going to be changed very dramatically, which means that we're going to have to remove the statues from the places where they are, and at the same time, we want to honor the legacy of the people who gave those statues and what they've meant to people over the years. So we have created, as part of our master plan, the Crystal Cathedral Ministry's Legacy Garden. And the Legacy Garden is being designed by master architects, and it will beautifully enshrine each of the sculptures that we are moving. They'll have a very prominent place of their own. And in some ways, in my opinion, the way that we have it planned, they'll even be displayed more beautifully than they are now.
Throughout the existing campus, there are a number of lovely statues. Those statues will find their way to the Crystal Cathedral Ministries Garden. This will be a beautiful garden that one will be able to walk around and be able to see all of the beautiful statuary that has graced the campus in many instances for decades. In addition, they're also going to be able to see a one-to-one sized replica of every Walk of Faith stone.
The Walk of Faith stones were stones put in, a family donated a certain amount of money, and each stone is a representation of the shape of the star of the cathedral, and it has the name of the family who's being remembered and also a scripture quote.
The stones are a challenge for the Catholic community because they're very fragile and they're in the way of very needed and necessary improvements. When the stones are removed, they often break. So the community, the Catholic community, has gone out of its way to first digitize and preserve electronically every single stone.
We are going to have a beautiful structure that literally is built out of replicas of each of those stones. And so there'll be walls that will be reproductions. They won't be in stone, they'll be in metal, of the star shape, the scripture quote, the family name, and the location. So it will be an exact replica of each of the Walk of Faith stones. We're very excited about that because this campus to us was a great gift. And to carry on the message of our Lord in this beautiful place and remember the people who originally built it is very important to us. And we really think that we'll have a suitable place for the sculptures and for the Walk of Faith to continue to live for the rest of the life of this cathedral campus.
The ultimate goal of Catholic education is to produce adults who are strong in the Catholic faith and have the academic knowledge to serve the community.
My son is in first grade. From the minute they walk in the door, I believe faith is a big importance to the students and the staff here.
They pray at the beginning of the day, which is fabulous.
They're teaching them how to live their life the way God wants them to live.
And the kids bring that home. I see my son bringing that home.
As a parent, that still gives me like peace of mind that they're going on the right path.
But why would you use it? Now explain yourself.
They have a loving and very caring instructors there. They treat the students like their own children.
The technology here is just astounding.
I really do see that they really care for the child.
I envision Christ Cathedral Academy really becoming the new renaissance in Catholic education.
We have parents and students from different parts of the world.
It allows each student to learn about different cultures while they're here, different customs.
Catholic schools are dedicated to providing an education to those most in need.
They do have financial aid. I have six children. I don't think that without it we would be able to attend.
we will do everything in our power to ensure that those who truly desire a Catholic education can obtain one.
I can't even put into words how much this school has meant to me and my husband with my son. He's just blossomed at this school.
If you're looking for a great, loving, caring institution, somewhere where they instill those wonderful values that we all want in our children, if you're looking for a place where you know your children's going to be safe, if you're looking for a place where they have teachers that genuinely care about the children, look no further than Christ Cathedral Academy.
Every parent can know that no matter what, that Christ Cathedral Academy is there for your child and for you, and they will not give up on you.
I love the place.